the album feels like a gift because we couldn't have afforded to go into a studio otherwise. It's a miracle it was even made at all, to be honest. There's politics in there, and there's personal sadness and struggle, and there's watching family members and friends of family struggle, and it just feels like a snapshot.
We carried on regardless and we played some shows and texted all our friends and everyone we know.
You know, it's that thing of looking out of apartment block and seeing everyone in all the different windows. Some people doing the washing up, some people are watching TV, some people are sleeping. It's just 11 different stories. If we can afford ourselves the time to make records for a long time, it would be great to look back and look at all these records as moments in our life.
It's a title game that old dogs play. You be the freshest me or the weakest prey.
This album would not have happened without Tim Rice-Oxley. I met Tim about 3 years ago. I feel like my writing process hasn't really changed in 10 years until I met Tim. This far faster way of writing is quite a significant shift. And I think the story of the album became the excitement and wonder of being that creative. We were in his beautiful studio and everyone was just so motivated by that and by his blessing. We did it all without thinking, really. It felt like we sort of barely opened our eyes, to be honest.
And it dawned on me that I think about you every minute. It dawned on me that I'm not good enough to you.
I remember the first time when I went to Tim's house and saw his studio. It was just... it was amazing because from the outside it looks like a barn, but it's got these huge big windows that light floods into this live room. And then, you know, upstairs he had like a residential space where the band all stayed, and we'd all come in at 10 every morning and get coffee on and cook breakfast. And you open the door to the studio and it's burnt toast and bacon, and there was such a lovely atmosphere in there. And it was all kind of because of Tim's generosity. And this magical rural studio in these rolling East Sussex hills. It was January, it was these bright blue skies, cold, cold, cold. And just, you know, endless rounds of tea and coffee, and Jake and Keys is having a cigarette out the door. And it felt like we were like a big happy family living in a shoe in some sort of fairy tale. So the band for this record was Jack Clayton on drums. And Jack's an amazing drummer. He's got great feel and he holds the whole thing down. On bass, we've got Igor Dalvanci, and him and Jack lock in beautifully. And I love Igor's playing. It's incredibly musical. It's incredibly sympathetic. Keys, Jake Mayhew. I feel like Jake is our secret weapon. He's a real whiz. He's a synth nerd. And I think going into a studio like Tim Rice-Oxley's, who's also a keyboard player, every plugin or soft synth that we'd used in demos and stuff, Tim had the real ones. And I think for Jake, it was so great to see him really indulge. And actually, it was also great for me to realize that I can expand what my music sounds like. It doesn't have to be guitars and drums all the time. And it's really changed my outlook. And then on guitar, we've got Ant Vickery. He was my best man at my wedding. He's my best friend, and he's been my musical sidekick for, yeah, a decade. He plays harder and better and more expressively on this record than he has ever, I think. And then producing was Tim Rice-Oxley, you know, the main songwriter in Keane, but also he's kind of co-produced most of those Keane records. And Tim was always so calm. Tim came in on the talkback, and he's the most polite man in the world. And he said, "How about you just put a kick all the way through that breakdown?" And we were like, I said, "Well, Tim, it's a bit cheesy, isn't it?" And this is Tim Rice-Oxley diplomacy. He says, "It depends how popular you want the song to be." Which was like such a cold put down. It's like, do you want people to like this music or not? The name of the album is What Did You Want To Be, and it came much later, but it's a question that children have asked me before as a guitar teacher. And I always laugh because it kind of feels like they're saying, like, what did you really want to be? Like, surely this isn't the job you wanted to do. And I think what they mean is, did your life go to plan? Are you okay? Are you happy? And also, like, am I going to be okay? It's quite a loaded question. Skull crusher, night screamer, blood buzzing, bad sleeper, cracked jaw, just another nosebleed, still shaking, crying at the TV.
That can't be on the film.